Today I'm going to present something on the state of Nagaland. Before I start, I'd like to know how many of you are familiar with Nagaland? So usual suspects? In terms of, you know, the basic geography, the divisions of Nagaland into, you know, whatever. A few of them at least. So, right. So, presuming that most of you have limited familiarity with that state, I'm going to first show you a map of India to show you where exactly this state is. So, this small state in that corner is Nagaland, okay? So, you see that it is on the extreme northeast side of the country. Then, now this is the district map of Nagaland. Initially, Nagaland was a single district, and then in 1957, they made three districts out of that single district. And then slowly, now you have 11 different districts in the state. Now, these districts are divided, you know, into three different zones. So you have the Kohima zone, which is dominated by the Angami people. Then you have the Mokokchung zone, which is dominated by the Ao people. The Aos were the first to convert to Christianity, and they are the most advanced tribe in the state. And then the third is the Truensang region. This is dominated by the Konyak tribes, okay? Now, then you see, let's go to the geography of this, of the natural geography of the state. These three tribal communities occupy mutually exclusive areas in the state. Historically, so you see, this is the Mokokchung Ao zone. So it is mostly in the valleys and the plains. And then you have the Kohima Angami zone, which is on a slightly higher elevation. And then you have the Truensang zone, which is the highest elevation, and most of it is hilly there. Okay. Now these are, you know, so you see that these tribes have occupied, as Purnendu would say, ecologically different niches in the ecology of that area. They have different niches. Somebody is on the hilltop, somebody is slightly in the hills of medium height, and then people closer to the plains of Assam. Now, this gives you a picture of a state which seems to be completely divided between the tribes. Then there are non-tribal people as well, and non-Naga tribals there. So this is Dimapur. It is the only broad plain area there, and it is this. To travel to Dimapur, you don't need to take special permits. So the non-tribals can go and settle there. Right? Now, this was not part of Nagaland till the First World War. In the First World War, Dimapur Thana was shifted from the Shiv Sagar district to the Naga Hills district to make it economically sustainable. Dimapur has the only civilian airport and the railway station in the entire state. So this is the entry port for the state. Right. Now, having introduced you to the basic geography and political and the natural geography of the state, please note one more thing. People living in this part of the state, if they have to come here, so they have to travel by Assam. The reason is that the road network in Assam is much better than the road network in Nagaland. Okay. So now I'll begin the main presentation. Before I start, start, I want to ask you a question. What do you think is essential for the normal functioning of a modern state? And an input without which a modern state cannot function at all. Law, social order, transport.
Surplus.
I think the most important thing for a modern state to exist even is the data. A modern state is extremely conscious about how many people are living in that state. You see, the moment Britishers came to India, they started counting how many thakurs, how many pandits, etc., etc. Right? And then so I think data is the most important thing for modern state to survive. If you see the definition of a modern state in the Montevideo Convention, it says a state is a territory with well-defined area, which is measurable area, and a well-defined population, again measurable population. Now if a state does not know how many people are there, it cannot find the per capita GDP, etc., etc. So numbers are extremely important. So today I'm going to speak on a specific data issue related to the state of Nagaland. Now in this age of satellite imagery, we can find this surface area extremely easily. So we have one of the data series with us, which is very reasonably precise. But then how many people live in this state is something that has puzzled administrators ever since the dawn of British rule in the state. So in 1870s, when the British census commissioner approached Nagaland, he said, "We have no idea how many people live here. It's just a ballpark estimate that there are some 97,000 people." And he said that the area of the Naga Hills district is around 4,900 square miles. Later on, both the numbers turned out to be incorrect. Now, today, 140 years afterwards, we'd like to know if the government of India knows anything more than the British Census Commissioner in 1871. Right? So now the government of India knows that the area of the state is 16,573 square kilometers. How many people are there? Is a puzzle, which I'm trying to resolve here. So paper titled "The Demographic Somersault of Nagaland." So between 1971 and 1981, the population of Nagaland grew by 40%. Now we generally assume that as the literacy rate goes up, as the female empowerment, improves, you expect that the fertility is going to decrease. Because, when literacy rate goes up and when per capita income, female empowerment and female workforce participation improves, so then you expect that you can achieve your target of, children with fewer number of pregnancies, and you don't use children as sources of social and economic insurance. So you expect as the literacy levels increase and etc., so the growth rate should decrease. But in the state of Nagaland, every improvement in literacy has been accompanied by a much sharper increase in the growth rate, which is contrary to the development economics or like health economics understanding of how fertility responds to socio-economic changes. So you see, so you have this is almost consistently at least two times the national average. But then all of a sudden, between 2001 and 2010, the population declined in absolute terms. So from 65% growth rate, all of a sudden the growth rate became minus 0.5%. This is first time in the history of maybe any part of South Asia where the population has turned negative despite no change in the related parameters like health indicators and you know, I'll just take you to the next slide where I list the things. So to the area of the state was fixed. Insurgency which leads to a few killings, you know, had you know, become almost nil after the two, you know, ceasefire agreements between the government of India and the underground organizations. So, and there was no major natural calamity. So, how come all of a sudden the population drops so sharply within 10 years' time? In fact, if you see the data, because we are using census, other sources seem to suggest that this decline happened in merely 4-5 years only. So this is the puzzle that I want to throw light on. Now let us look at the literature on demographic puzzles. So if you see, Donald Horowitz has a global survey of, you know, how political conflicts, you know, are related to demography, how it leads to higher, you know, growth, population growth rates, or at least concern about fertility, and your corresponding increase in the voting rate. So you see, Hindus and Muslims are concerned about who is growing faster. Okay. Now, then similarly, you know, Hindus and Muslims would say they are going to vote more as a bloc, so we should also go and vote more. Okay. So, Donald Horowitz has surveyed this for the entire globe. He's looked at the 50 years of conflicts and done that. But he doesn't give a, he doesn't look into the specifics of cases. He does not, of course, touch Nagaland, you know, in that case. Then Thorsten, you know, has a recently published forthcoming paper on politicization of fertility. Concern about who is growing faster and, you know, whose, you know, faster growth will translate into political control, etc. But he gives a formal theoretical model of this. Then you have literature on your post-colonial borders. So you have Clifford Geertz, whom I have not mentioned yet, I'm sorry for that. Alberto Alesina, Pierre Engelbert, who say that, you know, post-colonial borders have divided people who are, you know, for instance, Bengal. So Bengali-speaking people have been divided. So you can expect some of them to migrate. And these migrations lead to, abnormal population changes. Now, then there's a different, you know, take on this. Jeffrey Herbst and S.E. Baju, he's a Nigerian sort of scientist, or historian, political scientist, merged together. So they say, that, well, this is not true necessarily, and you have to look case by case. You cannot make a general theory of post-colonial borders, and they have a strong case. They again do not look into details of elections, censuses, etc. They just give you a broad argument looking at the post-colonial borders in Africa. Then you have more concrete cases come from Yugoslavia, where you had Serbs, Croats, etc. fighting with each other. So there, you know, they Slack and Doyen have linked, have used Holzack's competition or ecological competition theory to explain conflict between groups, and they say that the concerns about fertility are, they show the concerns about fertility are higher in mixed areas, where you have Serbs and Croats staying together, or Serbs and Bosnian Muslims together. Similarly, there is some literature on the Northern Ireland conflict, which looks at roughly similar things. And finally, you come to America. In America, there has been a long-standing debate on the uses and misuses of census. So they say felon disenfranchisement. So the argument is that had the prisoners been accounted properly in the census and the election process, Al Gore would have won the election because most of them are blacks, etc., etc. So just by projecting, so they said that, so just by discriminating against prisoners, you're actually distorting the political system. Then the second round, similarly around the same time, there was this argument that in the previous American general census, blacks and minorities were at least 5 times more likely not to be counted than a mainstream person. Said this again leads to distortion because the allocation of political seats is, the congressional seats is on the basis of these census. Okay, they said this kind of miscount or overcount, undercounts are distorting the political system and the distribution of federal funds. Right. Finally, Bangladesh. This is very close to our case because it is neighboring. Secondly, here there's a genuine miscount in 1970s. Begum and Miranda, in a very interesting paper, completely dismantle the authenticity of 1971 Bangladesh election. Sorry, 1970s Bangladesh census. Right? But none of these papers have seen election because each one of them is linking census to election. But then you have to look at election data simultaneously with the census data to make a robust claim about their interlinkage. Then you have the Indian literature. So Bernard Cohen has a celebrated paper on the history of census in India. Census of Punjab, Gill has looked at the fluctuation, the sharp changes in the population of Punjabi speakers in Punjab. Andhra Pradesh, Kumar and Sharma have discussed how the Andhra Pradesh, census of 2001 is wrong because it undercounts the number of households. And so therefore the actual population is more than the census population that has been declared. Then Sharma and Kar, who look at 100 years of census in the northeast of the country, but again they just look at birth and death rates of the region. Then you have somebody on just one particular tribe in Maharashtra. And the only thing that comes close to demography and election data come together is the paper by Pehel. Pehel, looks at how much impact the family planning had on the subsequent election after the emergency was, declared invalid, etc., whatever, was lifted, So there they say that there is no link. The link is not the election patterns are explained more by the political alliances rather than family planning or any other coercive program launched during the emergency. So this is it. Now we can thinking of the specific case of Nagaland, we can look at 3 or 4 different explanations. The first explanation is the Sharma and Kar kind of explanation. It is simple demography. So look at the birth rate, look at the previous census population, add the number of births, subtract the number of deaths, and then adjust for migration. These numbers have to add up. If they don't add up, there's some problem there. And then there's this argument that Nagaland, being one of the most HIV affected states of India, it could have an impact on the population. So these are the demographic explanations. We can similarly think of political geographic explanations. Post-colonial borders have divided people, so it could lead to some unnatural movement, unnatural from the point of view of a modern state. We think that these people should be here because they're citizens of this place. So there are certain gradients that promote migration, and this migration is reflected in the unusual fluctuations in the census. Now, this is really true that there are a number of Naga tribes which are not staying in Nagaland, so you can expect to and fro between them. And then there is this perennial Bangladeshi problem there, the entire northeastern region, but is often ignored. Outside Guwahati and Shillong, is that the Nepalese people are also present across the region in a big way. So they went, as you know, they went with the Gurkha regiment. Then there are Bhutanese traders, and then the Tibetan traders. The next set of explanations can be grouped under the political economic explanations. So this is competition for political power, and by implication the resources of the state. Now there are different conflict diets, hills, plains, tribal, non-tribal. Within the Naga tribes and the non-Naga tribes, Kukis, Mikirs, Dimasa Kachari, Mesh Kachari, and then within the dominant Naga tribes, for instance, Tema Angami, there's a big conflict between them, and then among the Konyaks of Tuensang, Mokokchung Aos and Angamis of Kohima, there's a conflict. So there are different divisions. Now we'll examine each one of them one by one. Now start with the demographic explanation. The demographic explanation says that you can carry out an internal and external validation of. So we can carry out an internal and external validation of these census. So the internal validation simply means that the birth rate, the death rate, and previous census population and the migration numbers have to add up neatly. Okay, and the external validation means that I would take a death rate from a different source. So I'll take a death rate, crude death rate from the sample registration system or from the civil registration system, or from the National Family Health Service, okay, and then say that because these surveys have been carried out, or these registrations have been carried out in the concurrent period, so if we use them, there should not be a big difference between the final outcomes, right? Even though different surveys have different methods of counting people, so they are not strictly comparable, but they will be within a margin of error. Okay, so we make a very strong assumption that between 91 and 2001 nobody died. Okay, assume that nobody died, and assume that that there was no migration. Okay, now the migration argument I'll expand earlier, and assume that in the second scenario, we say the people died at the rate declared by the sample registration system and then the National Family Health Service. The interesting thing here is that the growth rates as per nobody died are half the growth rate of the actual growth rate. So even if nobody is dying, still the growth rate is half of the actual shown by the Census of India. So the numbers are not adding up, because these are two sample registration system and national family health systems surveys, you know, have a reasonable accuracy. So you can say that it could differ by 10%, but it could not differ by 2 times, right? So, you know, so that is one problem. Now, HIV/AIDS, we looked at the number of deaths in each district, okay? And we compared them with, you know, 6 other high, you know, HIV/AIDS areas in country. And we find that all the, you know, HIV deaths can at most explain less than 1% of the discrepancy. So if I add the HIV deaths to this data, at most explain 1% or less than that of the discrepancy that I shown you. So let's look at the migration. So in the beginning I showed you a map in which I said that Dimapur town is the only area in the whole state where you don't need permits and people can go settle there. That small, you know, speck on the map has at least 15% of the state's population packed into 3% of its area, or 3 or 4% of its area. Now, because, you know, and the reason is that the hills cannot support high population density. So you need plains in which, you know, people settle. Now, you can have, you know, people from outside the state also coming and settling in that area. It is one of the most diverse, you know, cities of the country. I think more diverse than New Delhi, I guess. Because going by the number of languages spoken there, so there will be at least on any given day, at least 60 to 70 different tribal languages being spoken simultaneously in the bazaar, right? Now, the problem with the argument saying that, you know, the population grew, so people, you know, use a very interesting argument here. They say that the Bangladeshis and whatever people are coming and flooding the state, so the population was growing abnormally till 2001, and then they keep quiet. Now my question is that if the Bangladeshis are responsible for the initial hike, but then now you are arguing that they're leaving, right? Okay, now so far so good, but the problem is that if the Bangladeshis are coming at the height of insurgency, then they should be coming in still larger numbers after the end of insurgency, right? So because the economic opportunities have grown and the risks have diminished, right? So the argument that, you know, somebody from outside or from the plains of Assam or Bihar is coming and flooding the state is not entirely acceptable. So now let's see, can we combine birth, death and migration to see, you know, if you can have a nice argument to explain things. So I say, well, here, you know, let me make a small remark. Though you see that the numbers are coming up neatly on the screen, it took ages to find the data because for northeast of India, the government of India does not have consistent survey scheme. So most of the smaller states do not are not represented in the national surveys. So you have to, you know, pull together a large number of sources and, you know, verify them and do things. So now here, you know, I mean, after so this is the total change in population in a decade. Okay, this is the number of people who have moved into the state. This is net of people who have left the state. So if you subtract this from this, so you get the natural growth rate of the state, okay, due to births, after subtracting the deaths that have taken place in that decade. Now, here, you know, we argue that in between two censuses, the only natural growth that can take place is in the 0 to 9 years age group. So, somebody who is born in 2011 will be 0 years old, somebody born in 2002 would be 9 years old now, okay. So, this is the only, you know, after taking away migration, etc., etc., so the only growth would be in this, you know, group. But the natural growth is, you know, net of deaths, okay, which means that the total natural growth of a population should be less than the natural growth in this, you know, age group, because deaths are divided between 0 to 9 and 10 to 100, but births are entirely concentrated in the 0 to 9. So this should be more than this. So when we subtract this from this, we should get a positive non-zero number. Here we are getting consistently negative numbers, and the magnitude of discrepancy is growing. So from 30,000 people who should have been dead are shown in these census, and this number keeps on increasing. From 32 it goes to 125,000, and then goes to 350,000 people who should have been dead naturally but are still around in these census records. This is a huge discrepancy. So migration, birth and death rates alone cannot explain the sudden increase and then decrease in the population of Nagaland. Now, we'll see, it could be that there are mistakes in the census and we can try to correct them using a few techniques that we know in demography and economics and other disciplines. So, let's see. So, you know, so you say, well, okay, fine, from 1971 to 2001, there was a problem in the census. Let me go back to pre-1971 era and try to extrapolate from there and find what is the long-run trend. So, pre-1971, the first complete or at least purportedly complete census of the state was in 1961. Okay. But then pre and post 1971 data is not directly comparable, because in 1961 till 1963 the state has been expanding. There are newer units coming and merging with the state. So you have to control for the area of the territory and then make adjustments and then compare things. So now, here I will confine the presentation to 1971 onwards, but you know, we have results for the previous period. So we can use a number of different sources here. So far we have not been able to do the national sample survey and the church registers. The national sample survey has something on the migration trends in Nagaland, so that is the only thing that they can help us with, and the church registers is something about the population in the state, because every church has a membership and you know precisely how many people have attended a mass or not. Right. Now, when we start, we say, well, you know, when you have something so precious and sacred as a census, you don't feel like saying, I'm going to discard it in one go. So, you say, well, let me see if I can salvage parts of it. So, census can be divided into age groups, tribes, language groups, religious groups, and migrant communities, okay? And we are going to look at each one of them one by one. So now, right. So, we first look at the age groups and sex or gender, as we see. So we are going to define a contrand ratio, which, you know, we measure the expected ratio of the observed population to the expected population. And if this ratio is more than one, then red flags should go up. Now, so we do this analysis for both male and female categories. Now here this is the I should have drawn it from here, I'm sorry. And so you see that almost till the age of 54, the contrand ratio for almost every census from 71 to 2001 is above this cutoff. So it should be from here, which means that the discrepancy is found in all age groups at least up to the age of 50. So there is some, you know, value in the 50 to 70 plus age group, but we should also keep in mind that that majority of the, or the overwhelming majority of the state's population is below 50 years old, which means we cannot save any age group. The information about age group is incorrect. Now, one could argue that in most of the developing countries, people don't tell their age correctly. So for unmarried girls, the reported age would be less than the actual age, and for married girls, it would be more. That's one argument, at least in Bangladesh context. And then the other argument is that people don't have birth certificates, etc. So they say, well, I was born 2 years after the big incidents, such and such. Okay. So we assume that people, you know, are age heaping. Age heaping is that, I mean, people are giving approximate ages. So even after making that assumption, find that this most of the age groups are above the cutoff line. So which means that even after making and we make an extremely strong age heaping assumption that everyone gives only 10, 15, 20, 25, these kind of ages. And like even after making such a strong assumption, we find that the discrepancy persists. Now, let us try to see if we can save rural or urban, you know, census of the state. So if you see, the urbanization started with something around 5% when it was formed, and like all the way up to 29% in the latest census. In 1981 and 2011, a number of new towns were notified, so you see a discrete jump in the urbanization. Over the last 100 years, the growth rate of urban areas has been more than rural areas in Nagaland. So this is the first general observation about the data. And the only exception to this is the period 1991-2001, when the rural population also grew at a rate comparable to the urban population. But then, surprisingly, after growing at the rate of 65% in the previous decade, in the latest decade, the growth rate in the rural area is minus 15%. Again, so they said, well, initially the growth rate was such. So then the argument till 2001 was that the growth rate in the rural area is less because people are going to cities. Right? And then between 91 and 2001, it was that they stopped going or people coming back. Now again the growth rate has declined, so we are saying again they are going to cities. So it's like an ad hoc, you know, treatment of the issue. What we try to do is that, we try to compare the population changes in the two, the rural and the urban censuses, and find that 240,000 people were missing in the rural areas, and 230,000 people appeared in the urban areas. Now, in the urban areas, they might have been but the problem is that the urban areas, even in the latest censuses, have been growing at the long run trend. So this 2040 actually is not, only a small fraction of it is going to the urban areas. Otherwise, you know, there's a discrepancy here. I showed you 240,000 a number earlier, that there's a negative, that these guys should have been dead, they're still around in the census. Again, we have some 240,000 people who should not have been in the state and are still there for some reasons. Now let us look at the, so we cannot save the male-female breakup, we cannot save the urban-rural breakup. Now let us see if we can break the, we can save the scheduled tribe census. So Nagaland has 5 different scheduled tribes. Unlike other states of India, Nagaland gives scheduled tribe status to only few of the, to collection of tribes. Okay. It gives, you know, so 5 tribes, for instance, the Naga tribe has at least 16 sub-tribes. The Kuki tribe has, you know, something like 30 sub-tribes, okay. Mikir, Kuki, Naga, Mikir, Garo are the 4, and then Kuki, and then there's one Mikir, Garo, and Dimasa Kachari. Now, the Nagas form a majority of the population, 80%, okay. And almost they are more than 90% of the rural population. So we saw that there is problem in the rural areas. Now because Nagas are almost 90% of the rural population, so anything that, I mean, so if we can somehow say that, you know, if it is, if we can find a discrepancy in the population of the Naga tribe, so then we can say that even the, we cannot save any tribal census also from being scrapped. So you see, the Semas, Angamis, Konyaks, Foms and the Changs, the members of this tribe or the language speaking communities, they registered abnormal changes between 1971 and 2001. The Konyaks grew at the rate of 5% between 71 and 81, and from 81 onwards they have been growing at a great rate, 80%, 90%. Right, so it's like, you know, somebody who flunked all his life and then suddenly turns out to be Nobel Prize winner. So they're consistently at that level. There was one decade in which the Angamis had a serious discrepancy. In 1991-2001, the Semas had a serious discrepancy. The Foms then Changs have a growth rate of some 324% and 485%. It's like human beings don't, you know, procreate at this rate at all. But anyway, they are. Now you see, now look at the diligence. Here we can save the census. Because, you know, even though there have been spectacular changes in the population of Christians, but we have clear-cut explanation for that. We have, you know, Richard Eaton in his Indian Economic and Social History paper, he explains how these changes have happened, and then there's a more recent paper by Thong, who himself is a Naga, who has explained how these changes have taken place. So from around 5% in 1921, or from less than 50% in 1950, the population of Nagaland become entirely Christian among the tribals within 50 years. And this has happened, after the draconian Hindu government of India imposed everything on the state. But there are neat and clean explanations, psychological, historical explanations. So here we can save the tenses in this regard at least. Socioeconomic characteristics. None of the socioeconomic correlates of population growth have changed abnormally. So we have a problem here. But we know that, the tribes which are relatively less developed, which are socioeconomically backward, are growing at a faster rate than the advanced tribes. This much is clear and like it's very well established. So you can sort of say that at least one standard. So interestingly, the theory which holds that the level of tribes is not holding, and you sum up all the tribal populations. So we have isolated 19 elections to compare with the census, though we have data for at least 24 something elections. Now these are the three cutoffs that we take into account when we discuss the election results in the paper. Now we perform a number of consistency checks on the election data. We do it at the level of individual assembly constituency. Okay, so there's 60 constituencies and 19 elections or 24 elections. So for all the 24 elections, all the 60 assemblies have been examined. Right. So we see that there's a reasonable consistency there, and the inconsistencies which is seen a short while. So this is the people who are more than 18 years old are eligible to vote in an election. Till 1989 it was 21 years. Okay. So now what we do, we find the shape. I'm assuming that the electoral role doesn't discriminate, and everybody is allowed to enroll himself or is enrolled. The share of above 18 population in the census and the above 18 election role should be coincident. They should be equal in the ideal case, or at least they should be within a small margin of error. Okay. Now what we see here is that a long run trend analysis of the above 18 or above 21 population in the state shows that the ratio between the electoral roll and the total census population should not be less than 62%. Looking at 50 years data. Now, whenever this ratio goes below 62%, we need to think how is it's happening. So here we know that this happened because the eligibility criteria was changed, and there were some problems in making the new electoral roll. But after the eligibility criteria has been fixed, you'd expect something of this kind or something smoother. Here, you know, between 91 and 2004, you see a very distinct, inexplicable dip in the ratio. So it means that because we're looking at 50 years of election and for across 24 elections, so we need to, we are more sure, relatively sure about the trend of election, and we need to think about why exactly it has dipped. So it could be that the overall population has been overreported. So if the overall population is overreported in the census, so then the population in the electoral roll is fixed. So numerator is fixed and the denominator is increasing. So then you have a dip in the curve. But then we can also check the right. So here we find the long run growth rate using electoral size and the census data, and we see that there is roughly a ratio of 1.5 or more than that between the growth rate as per the census and growth rate as per the election data. Again, you know, initially I showed you that as per the no death or the SRS, you know, benchmark, the growth rate is half the growth rate of the census. Now here, then we start comparing, we think, well, let's compare the sex ratios. So the election commission declares the sex ratio of you know, sorry, they give you how many males and females have voted in election. So we look at the people who have voted, people who are registered as voters, male, female, people who voted, and the census, right? Here you see this is plus minus 5% of the census thing. This is the line for the people who are registered as voters in the state, and this blue line is for the people who are registered, who have actually voted on the day of election. So you generally see that these lines, if you look at their average, they are more or less close, or there is no pattern of significant divergence. But if you look between 1994 and 2004, in the previous slide also you saw that there is a depression here. Here again, because assuming that males and females are equally likely to be registered in the election database, and they are equally likely to vote. Because, you know, these are state level aggregates, so it could be that in certain constituencies females are voting less and some males are voting more, but when you aggregate them across the state, the biases should disappear. Because, you know, if they are rural constituencies in which a man is registered there and he migrates to a city for work, so he's not working there, he's not voting there, etc. Then if you aggregate for the whole state, these, you know, migration patterns shouldn't matter at all, or at least not a lot. So you again have a discrepancy here, and you see that the census population and the election population are moving in the same manner here, you see. So there's some problem in this stretch of around 10-15 years where you had misreporting. I mean, this is suspected. In middle school going children, and we see that the growth rate of enrollment in Nagaland is more than India as a whole. This is understandable because, you know, it was a relatively underdeveloped state in the beginning. So as more schools are opened, the enrollment catches up, so initially the growth rate would be high. But there's something interesting. In India, the gross enrollment, number of school-going children divided by the population of the school-going children is increasing. So, which means that more and more children are going to schools. In Nagaland, this is decreasing. Interesting. Okay. Now the only reason that this seems to make sense is that the people have misreported overreported their numbers in a particular decade or 1.5 decades. So you see that in fact more than 1.5 decades, right? So we have another confirmation. We have a confirmation that above 18 population is misreported. We have a confirmation that below 18 population below 15 population misreported. So putting them together, we can say that the entire population has been misreported. And we have seen earlier the Kondran curves. which also showed, you know, here we are saying, so there we have a third confirmation of over-reporting population. So is the census indeed erroneous? So we know that in Assam 1981, you know, the census had to be cancelled. Political disturbances. Kashmir 1991 census cancelled, again political disturbances. 1971 census, happened in a hurry because of the India-Pakistan war on the Bangladesh front. So it could be, but in Nagaland, the census was never cancelled despite it being dubbed as the mother of all insurgencies, right? So so how much time do I have now? Am I already? 4:30. So I have, so I'll take 5 minutes or 10 minutes and bear with me till then. Now, so you know, it could be that the reach of one argument that we try to explore is it that because Nagaland, you know, came under the administrative cover in stages, so maybe initial censuses couldn't penetrate as far as the remote areas, so they were moving in stages. So with each census, the reach of census increases, so the population increases. So you have 10 people and they grow at the rate of 2 per decade, they become 12, but there's a new area which is covered by the census. So instead of the population being 12, it becomes some 15 or 16. Now if this is true, we said, well, the geography could support this argument, and the administrative history since the British period could support this argument. But if this is true, this will explain one time spikes in individual regions and the communities of those regions. But unfortunately, the spikes are not just one time spikes. It goes up and then stays there. So Konyaks, you know, they go up to 80-90 and they stay there, right? Or Tuen Sang increases, it stays there. It cannot be entirely explained by the argument that the reach of census has been growing over the years. Yes. See, the other thing is that the census of India sometimes carries out pre and post enumeration testings. Pre and post enumeration testings, they don't cover Nagaland as a state, because this is a small sample to work out, you know, the fine print, to fine tune the entire exercise. So they take Northeast as a whole. Okay. Interestingly, if this is to be believed, then the northeastern region, there was a slight undercount. So which means that the true population is even more than what has been the excess reported, you know, it is still more than that, if this argument is true. So there's something wrong in the Nagaland census. One interesting piece of, you know, information that we have is that the 62 villages which are disputed between the state of Nagaland and Assam, and there will be a number of Supreme Court cases, tribunal, boundary commissions of the small ones, Sundaram, Shastri, all these commissions, but it hasn't been resolved so far. So the census officials of both the states carry out census in those villages. Now the census of Assam gives a consistently lower population growth rate for the 62 villages than the census of Nagaland. This is one. Now I would stop here and quickly take you to two or three slides, because I've just finished one third of my presentation. Okay, so I won't, you know, burden you with the other parts. I'll just take you to the political geographic explanation. Here we show that looking at the census of all the countries and states around Nagaland, we say that the changes in those census cannot explain influx into Nagaland. Then we look at the illegal immigrants. So they say, well, no, it's not the legal immigrants, it is the illegal immigrants. So we also look at that, and at most illegal immigrants can explain a difference of 2 lakh or something, but not the entire difference. And we also look at the argument that some illegal immigrants are actually getting deported as local Nagas, and we look at feasibility of this and the impact of this on the total number. Then we look at different political economy arguments. I won't take you through the details, but one thing is important. The chief minister of Nagaland made a statement in 2003 or 2005, in fact to Sanjay Hazarika, that the population of Nagaland in 2001 was only 14 million. It was 1.4 million, it was not 1.9 million. So he says that the latest 1.9 figure is actually increased over 1.4. But then we discuss this and we say that this argument is untenable, because if it was 1.4 million in 2001 and 1.9 million in 2011, so which means between 91 and 2001 the growth rate was 16%, and from 2001 to 2011 the growth rate becomes 36%, which means that despite steady improvement in socio-economic conditions, despite the end of the insurgency, population growth rate has shown a perverse trend. So this argument, nephew Dio's argument doesn't make sense. Now I'll come to the, there are at least 9 different hypotheses, political economic hypotheses that we tried to test. I won't take you through all of them. I'll just show you my last slide. This is Twensang, this is Mokokchung, and this is Kohima. Okay, so you see that there is the population decreases and then it increases. The population increases and then decreases. So both these regions have, we conclude that both these regions have inflated population. Okay, and because of till 2001 the population increased and then it decreased only after when the chief minister threatened that anybody misreporting numbers will be penalized as per the, because the census act has penalties for people who don't report numbers correctly. He also said that you are free to misreport, I won't allocate funds based on inflated numbers. He said that everyone who comes to this there'll be a biometric scan. So we only count the biometric scans. We won't count the declared number. So a number of threats there. And then the chief minister did something which is novel in the history of India. He called all concerned people, the leader of the opposition, all parties, students, federations, churches, mothers association, and he sort of convinced them. You see that we have to have correct data for appropriate development planning and allocation of resources. Then each of these tribal assemblies and etc. and the village elders assembly issued their own statements saying that everybody has to honestly get up population figures. So this time, the latest census of Nagaland might be the only correct census in the history of India. But that's a different story, I won't go into that. Now this is the last slide and then I say namaste. In 1991, people who thought that the delimitation in 2002 is going to affect them, because our population is less, and if the new assembly seats are determined based on this population, we are going to lose political power. So these people inflated their numbers. So you see that their projected loss decreases is like non increasing in the inflation and the threat of delimitation in 2008. It's a very long story. I won't go into the details of the story. In 2008, the government of India was compelled to say that delimitation will not take place in Assam, Manipur, Nagaland, Arunachal Pradesh, Jharkhand and Kashmir due to law and order problems. Now the moment this threat of delimitation disappears, you see that there is a sharp change in the, and this has been postponed till 2031. So it's like no immediate threat of whatever, so they'll inflate again in 2021, but not now. Okay, so with this I end my presentation. I just say one last thing and then I'm done. Is that people are blindly using these statistics. No introspection at all. The Economics Survey of India, 8 years after the government of Nagaland rejected the census of Nagaland, continues to use the incorrect population theories. It says this, oh my God, the per capita income is going down and the per thousand people, hand pumps, etc. is going down. It will go down because number of hand pumps are not being inflated and number of people are being inflated. Okay. So, and then coming to a non-governmental organization, CSDS, Lok Niti pre-election survey in Nagaland, blindly uses the incorrect theories. And the survey is absolutely blind about the demographic concerns and how it affects election data. Or voting patterns in the constituencies. We have analyzed 50 years of voting patterns in all constituencies and seen how different communities are performing. The argument again is involved and detailed. I won't take you there. I'll say thanks a lot for your patience. Any questions, I'll be more than happy, because I'm going to present the same thing I'm going to present in New Delhi within 5 or 6 days, and it'll be a crowd of demographers and econometricians. So there I can display some more technical details, because they will, but if you have some questions on the general argument made here, please feel free to.
Mm-hmm. So the core of the argument is that the numbers reflect political pressures.
Is that
the core of the argument, that you can link it most closely to delimitation? Is that the argument?
That is half the argument. Because we say that it is not merely, because this explains only 10 to 20% of the discrepancy. It doesn't explain much more. So there has been a problem in the way census has been administered in that area. So long-standing problems with the way census is administered, and on top of that, in 2001, when the 2002 delimitation pending, and when these two things came together, then the population growth rates spiked to 64% in Nagaland. In northern Manipur's Naga dominated areas, it went to 120%.
And
he's got another question. Yeah.
If that political explanation is plausible, and what is this rest of the explanation? Because it comes to my mind that this is not new, it's not novel in the sense that all states are grappling with these kinds of numbers. For example, Andhra Pradesh counts 7.8 crore BPL cards, and it has 7 crore population. In Karnataka, when the present Food and Civil Supplies Minister tried to tighten up to connect gas connections with household, meaning the electricity meter, they found that the PDS number was inflated by a third. So my sense is that this kind of counting it seems to be driven by these, the economics of various social programs. Is that part of your story?
See, yeah, this, I'm not sure if you were there in the, during the literature survey that I presented. It is pervasive across the world, but to my knowledge, the literature seen from across from different countries in Asia and abroad, in Europe and America and in Africa, to my knowledge, no one has first constructed a long-run time series for this, and using so many different sources to tightly pin down the problem. Now, we still have not done the final calculation in which we estimate how much exactly has been misreported, and we are not aware of. So that will happen in a few days' time before present in New Delhi. And I'm not aware of, I've not been able to present all the details of the election and the political geography argument. I'm not aware of comparative treatment where people have brought together demographic, politics, geography, political economy, and linked all different kinds of socio-economic, political, and demographic time series and trying to make an argument. For instance, the Condren curve that I saw, to my knowledge, it hasn't been used in this manner in the Condren ratio has not been used in this manner for demographic cross checks in the literature. It is small innovations, and so the main contribution of the paper is to make a robust, because the chief minister and the census is saying only 2001 census may be incorrect, but we are making a long run claim. We are making a claim between 1971 at least. Here I have presented only from 1971, because before that, anyway, by their own admission, it is messed up. But from 1971 onward, when it shouldn't be messed up, it is shown to be there's a persistent discrepancy, and which can be linked to. At times to political, economic arguments of redistribution, because, here I haven't been so, is that people have done analysis that you think that, okay, this has been inflated by a third or whatever. Here we go down to each and every constituency, we go down to each and every tribe and say that, let me see if any one of their growth rates can be salvaged, each and every age group. So the contribution here is that the tightness with which we are pinning down the problem is, to my knowledge, not there in the literature for any country. Yeah.
Delimitation was stopped in Chhattisgarh, Manipur.
No. Jharkhand.
Jharkhand, Manipur, Assam. So similar situation was observed there also.
It was noticed in Manipur. In Jharkhand, the tribals didn't inflate the population. But when the census came out and they said, "My God, we are losing seats to the non-tribals," and they threatened that the peace would be disrupted, etc., etc. People went to the President of India, Prime Minister of India, and said that, the state made for tribals cannot accept a situation in which the tribal share in the assembly goes down. That's one. So they did after the fact. Kashmir Valley clearly declared that no matter what our population is, the Kashmir Valley has to dominate the assembly. Otherwise, we go to, not the people of Kashmir, but the leaders said we'll go Pakistan, China, Bhutan or Nepal, wherever. So the central government again said no. In Manipur, in the Senapati district in Taminglong, there has been a very high, population growth, 120%, 80%, because of which 9 subdivisions were supposed to be re-censused under the Guwahati High Court's decision, but each of the time these census people went there, the villagers deserted the village. Go and count hell, count of houses, whatever. So then the government Manipur rejected these census of Pau Mata, Mau Maram, and Purul, I think, subdivisions. And yeah, I mean, every 2001 census is that star marked. It doesn't include these three subdivisions, Manipur. So it happened Manipur. In Assam, you know, there wasn't a large scale inflation effort or that sort, but there were disturbances. I've also seen the Constituent Assembly debates, and concerns about delimitation for this right from that day itself. So in all the Naga dominated areas like Northern Manipur, Nagaland, upper, we suspect inflation. And we've also done something on the Manipur in this paper itself. We've shown that the population growth rates there are simply unsustainable. If 64% is not natural, 120% though is not at all natural.
For Nagaland, we have to see, if you have to really have to see the cause, we might have to go, I mean, how the SEMAs and Anganis are reporting. Because for the last 30 years, NSC1 was controlling everything, every aspect of the bureaucratic life. So there might
not
be...
Not exactly.
But census, in most of the villages, census often could not be held even.
We have done it at the level of, one of these sites showed that there are abnormalities in the growth rate of temas, forms, charms,
angamis
in one decade only, and semas, forms, cognacs, and charms, okay. Now, we have done that, the argument is that, without saying that the political disturbance is explaining the entire discrepancy. In fact, no one has an estimate of the discrepancy even. No one means no one, even the census, because the census has been so completely rigged that you cannot find the lower discrepancy. But we have gone down to that level, districts and that level, and we have information of how the changes are happening. So for instance, if you are interested in Temas and Angami, so this area is Tema.
Yes,
this Tema, okay. This area, this is Tema, okay. This is Cognac. This is, you know, this is Ao, this is Ao. And this is Angami, this is Delangrong, okay. So so we have information on that, no. Sorry, this is not Delangrong, this is Tilyam. So we have your information that level, and we have tried to see, but the scale of discrepancy is very difficult to pin down to a particular number.
It might be, but secondly, since the ceasefire, NSCN is demanding that a large part of Manipur has more number of Nagas than Manipur, and those areas, areas should be included in the greater Nagaland. They are demanding from Delhi. So it might, because in one of your slides there is one line that even in Manipur, there is an increase of Naga population.
Yeah.
So it might, because NSCN is controlling there almost all.
Manipur, it's not, story is complicated, and we look at it in great details in the paper. We go down to the Manipur, in fact the paper is built around the greater Nagaland, but then I didn't present it here because it would have taken the entire time just to explain the political aspect of controversy. But you know, see, NST and IM does not control everything. First of all, Cognac, the most important, the biggest tribe is with the NST and Khaplam.
Yeah.
That's one. Number two, ours are not with NSC and IM. They are half year, half day. They are very intelligent people. The Angamis are not with NSC and IM. The
Semas
are, and the Thambuls are. The Thambuls are there with NSC and IM, but these Delhiang people are not with NSC and IM. The Delhiang people are actually demanding a separate state. The Cognacs are demanding a separate state. It's a very strong movement. Greater Nagaland dream is not even a dream these days. Even if they can hold the state, existing state together, it would be a great thing. Because there are strong centrifugal movements there now, and which are demanding. See, I didn't present the election, the job quota information here. So there are correlations between backwardness and demands for a separate state, job quota, higher fertility. I couldn't also present the migration data from Myanmar and Bangladeshis who are marrying these Semas and settling in Dimapur. So Myanmar explains 100,000 or 150,000 discrepancy. So political economic argument explains something of that sort, 100 something thousand. So this 300,000 explains like that. So we are going to find precise numbers within reasonable limits of error in the thing. So Nissan IM doesn't control everything. In fact these Semas brutally beat up the IM people in Dimapur, and they could do nothing. They could do nothing because Semas, control Dimapur. They control Dimapur and nobody can speak against them in that area. Be it NSCN IM, be it the Chief Minister of the state, no one. Punendu.
The thing is, I fully realize that this is an explanation which is probably viable and plausible explanation. But if you leave aside the politics of it, and supposing you do think that this period of 25 years for certain groups perhaps represented certain opportunities in terms of resources, in terms of maybe access to both information and material things, then the kind of pattern of growth you're seeing, it is a typical pattern of growth of overshoot and decline. So it's not an irrational pattern. And especially if you look at the relationship between the different groups, if you look at this whole as a group, as a community, with the different groups, then clearly there are certain populations that are rapidly increasing, and there is an overshoot, and then it reaches a different level, a lower level. So it may be that the truth is a combination of things. There could be a political manipulation and things like that, but it could also be that to some extent growth may have reflected differential opportunities available for certain populations, and it could be interpreted a little differently.
Yeah.
But that is a very mechanical explanation I am giving.
No. This is something that we also considered, is that when Western medicine and modern hygiene, etc., comes to a tribal area, then you see a certain increase in birth rates. And death rates, come down, because earlier they used to be like this. Birth rate increases and death rate comes down, and there is a certain increase in the growth rate. Then death rate keeps falling out. But then the birth rate also falls, and then the growth rate decreases. But here the growth rate is increasing. In fact, with every decade, the increase in literacy, the growth rate shows a further increase.
No, you don't accept, supposing we don't accept that, because that's a very long term kind of trend you're talking about, in which you see that if it
70
gets,
years.
Yeah, it's a long term kind of thing, It's a Western kind of framework, you see. I'm not looking at it like that. I'm just saying, supposing there are certain expansion of opportunities in certain senses coupled to this, then this can be looked at as a rational pattern.
Huh, no.
Expected. It is not something that is in itself suspicious. attracting of suspicion. Except of course that the rates of growth are extraordinary. I said humanly not possible.
Yeah. No, yeah. See, the problem here is that I am absolutely prepared to accept that the cognac actually grows at 64%. 64% is, you know, achievable. 324% is not. But that type is small. So leave it aside. The problem is that even if we accept that all the numbers in these senses are true and they represent, you know, natural or rational responses to certain opportunities, the numbers should add up. But as I showed in one of the earlier slides, the census is consistently showing that the number of deaths has been, I mean, it's like, just a second, I'll just take 2 seconds to go back. Here you are. Yeah, so you see, here we are saying that, I mean, a change in population has to be equal to the birth rate minus death rate minus the outflow of plus inflow of people. But these, when you add all these numbers, they find that they don't add up. So if they, my concern is that the people are not there on the ground. Had they been there, I would have been happy that they are there and they are enjoying life, but you know, they are not there at all. So you see, the numbers, 350,000 people not there as per the summation in a state with population of 1.5 million. So it's like 30% of the population is unaccounted for. So I mean, the rational explanation controlling for the opportunities and the introduction of modern medicine, literacy, etc., still these things are happening.
The hands. Thank you.